In 1992, as a network news cameraman filming the LA riots, I came to wonder how we as a society had come to such a level of hatred. I decided to look back to a period of time, the 1960s, when people wanted human rights, when people thought they could change anything. And I wondered what happened to those people, what happened to that movement. And my questions became this documentary, All Power to the People.
Fact is that there are more slums that Negroes are living in the United States of America today than there were 20 years ago.
Yeah, that's right.
Fact is that the Negro is more hovered up in ghettos today, more segregated in housing today than 20 years ago. Fact is that schools, particularly in the North, are more segregated today than they were in 1954 when the Supreme Court rendered its decision outlawing segregation. These are the hard facts. I'm not trying to solve these problems. We've got to rise up. We've got to organize. We've got to mobilize. And we've got to work to solve these problems.
Well, it was a very controlled exercise. We were told what time to come into town, where we could march, where we could not march, the kinds of signs that we could carry. The speakers were told what to say. When you say the march on Washington, you get the perception that people are coming there angry or they're going to do something. It was a picnic. The final thing was we heard Dr. King's I Have a Dream. So everybody was emotionally clapping and so on. I felt quite sad as I looked at the people because it was an empty dream to me.
America has given the Negro people a bad check. A check which has come back marked insufficient funds. The idea whose time has come today.
I had responsibility for protecting his life on the march from Selma to Montgomery, and I spent 5 or 6 absolutely sleepless nights down there. I'd drive back and forth from Selma to Montgomery, and I'd look at every tree and around every corner and wonder, and up on the roof and wherever. any sniper could be, because I could feel the hatred drawn toward that place that wanted to kill him. And we had identified about 1,200 people who had histories of personal racial violence. I mean, they had tried to kill, they had assaulted, or they had murdered people on account of race, as far as I know, all whites, killing blacks. And here they were coming. They were drawn like a magnet towards Selma to Montgomery. And the man walked in the valley of the shadow of death for years. And he feared no evil.
There were a lot of lynchings and things that were going on that you never heard about because the news never left the South.
And the federal government had taken a larger position of standing by and observing what was going on. The FBI was not doing anything to protect the rights of the people who were peacefully demonstrating.
When you say power structure, I know you mean the white power structure, because that's all we have in America. And the white power structure today is just as much interested in perpetuating slavery as the white power structure was 100 years ago. Only now they use modern methods of doing so.
Blacks being beaten with baseball bats and the fire hoses and the dogs being sicked on blacks, marchers and protesters and people who were trying to vote. It was a very bitter pill to accept.
If you only ask for crumbs and the granting of those crumbs causes bloodshed, what do you think will be caused when you ask for a loaf of bread or a bakery in which to bake your own bread?
Well, let me continue with...
Go ahead, Ms. Walker.
There had been a very intense struggle around the question of denying black people the right to vote and access to public accommodations. And the South had been the focus of much of that struggle because that's where the contradictions were most blatant.
As long as the masses of black people are involved in the struggle for freedom, not integration, but freedom, respect as human beings, respect as men, and show that they're willing to die to be respected as men, then the power structure sits up and takes notice.
Dr. King's a man of unparalleled nonviolence among public figures in American history. And he studied nonviolence, and he studied Gandhi, and he studied Tolstoy. He studied Thoreau, and he absorbed their vision. And he came to understand that it was the only way that we'll avoid destroying ourselves. He could look at Hiroshima, and he could look at our massive arms expenditures and how it starved people and blew their bodies apart and all the misery of it. He could look at soaring crime rates, and he knew we couldn't go on like this, and he pleaded with us.
Hoover felt that one way maybe to silence Martin Luther King would be to invite him to his office.
J. Edgar Hoover said that Martin Luther King was a liar, and Martin Luther King had accused him of being a racist in his selection of FBI agents. So Martin Luther King said, I will go to Washington and I will have it out with him. I will certainly make him take that back and apologize to me. And then he did come to see J. Edgar Hoover. And they went down the hall and walked in an office together to talk. Finally, I inquired, and they said Martin Luther King had gone out of the door on the other side and had left.
Something influenced Martin Luther King, because I understand that at the end of the conference, he told the press that I think something to the effect that Hoover was a great man.
J. Edgar Hoover, who was believed to have had a number of tapes of Martin Luther King experiences with women, and that Martin Luther King was horrified, and that Hoover had accomplished his aim of shutting up Martin Luther King for the time being.
Martin Luther King, poor boy, is under the influence of the Foxes. I should say under the control of the Foxes, and has been used by the Foxes to lead the poor sheep right to the slaughter.
Malcolm was not afraid to speak the truth, and this was an eye awakening to people in general. I think even some of the whites started to see some things they could not see before.
There are many whites who are trying to solve the problem, but you never see them going under the label of liberals. That white person that you see calling himself a liberal is the most dangerous thing in the entire Western Hemisphere. He's the most deceitful. He's like a fox, and a fox is always more dangerous in the forest than the wolf. You can see the wolf coming. You know what he's up to. But the fox will fool you. He comes at you with his mouth shaped in such a way that even though you see his teeth, you think he's smiling and you take him for a friend.
They falsely accused Malcolm X as being violent, which Malcolm X did not, because all he taught people was self-defense. And self-defense doesn't mean you go out and attack someone, but you do have the right to defend yourself by any means necessary if you're in that position to defend yourself.
Malcolm, to us, represented a voice.
Why should the black man need some legislation to prove that he's a human being when you don't need any legislation to prove that whites are human beings? So I make this point because, to come right back to my initial statement at the outset of the program, you will never get real freedom and recognition between black and white people in this country without destroying the country, without destroying the present political system, without destroying the present economic system, without rewriting the entire Constitution. It'll be a complete destruction of everything that America supposedly stands for before a white man in this country will recognize a black man as something on the same level with himself.
Heads of governments and leaders of revolutionary movements listened to him and were convinced that there was a legitimate problem, a human rights problem that black people had in the United States, which was being covered up and concealed.
He hated all the things that decent people should hate. He hated racism and hypocrisy and oppression and the tyranny of those in power. And what he loved humanity, but of course, the humanity in this country, because of the racism, was not the kind of humanity that anyone could love. It would have to be a society that would have to be changed completely.
And I, for one, will join in with anyone, don't care what color you are, as long as you want to change this miserable condition that exists on this earth. Thank you.
Finish Malcolm. They had to get rid of him. After Malcolm was assassinated, I was at the Audubon Ballroom the day that it happened. It was a terrible thing to witness. And there are a lot of things that happened there that day that I don't understand, that have, and a lot of questions that have not yet been answered. People are still trying to puzzle out, a piece together what really happened and who was really responsible in terms of the actual participants. We know that the United States government planned it, did all of the plotting, and utilized used the Nation of Islam and some of Malcolm's own people to bring him down.
I found out later on after research that Gene Robbins was on the stage when Malcolm X got assassinated. I think he was a gold badge carrying detective. If you define what a bodyguard is, it's distinctly just that. You guard somebody's body with your body, and that makes you a bodyguard. So now how come any of us there is beyond me to jump in front of the bullets? They ain't supposed to be off the stage, down the stage, around the corner. Those are not bodyguards.
The CIA is completely very powerful in this country. Nobody knows how powerful.
The CIA had liaison projects with police forces all over the United States.
There was a chance of detente between Malcolm and King at the time of Malcolm's assassination. Two of the people arrested for the murder of Malcolm X were people that had not fired a shot that had hit the victims.
These activities were run by the counterintelligence staff of the CIA. It was put in counterintelligence in order to bury it as deep as possible within the agency and prevent exposure.
I find it a little strange that the FBI has informant files on so many people who end up assassinating someone.
If the CIA was doing it in New York, imagine they were doing it in country after country around the world.
Ah, well, if they had not killed Malcolm X, probably the Black Panther Party would not have evolved. I found these
Declaration of Independence piece, that first two paragraphs that said, when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for any one people to dissolve the political bondage which have connected them with another, when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursues and invariably evinces a design to reduce a people under absolute despotism. Well, this kind of phrasing, this kind of thinking, and our understanding, particularly to where I was coming from and my decision to help to create this organization, was all about this need to change and alter the government, to evolve some community control kind of political power back into the hands of African-American people in the black community. So we went down to the Warren Poverty Office, three blocks from my house, it's right there in North Oakland, and we sit down and decided right there by October 15th to start writing out this 10-point platform and program for this new organization.
Many people don't understand that the Black Panther Party's 10-point program and platform was basically a statement of principles. And it was around these principles that we organized in the black community.
Point one said, we want power. We want power to determine the destiny of our own community. And it went through a series of issues.
We wanted decent housing. We wanted to determine the destiny of our community.
Decent education taught us about our true history. We wanted fair treatment in the courts, juries of our peers.
We wanted to end to police brutality. We wanted a relevant education that taught us who we were and our role in society.
We wanted land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, and peace. We wanted to organize political, electoral, black community power.
The point was not to show what the government was not doing. The point was to show the community how the community could empower itself and how the community could organize.
So we wrote this program, 10 points of what we want, then 10 collateral points of what we believe.
And these principles and stated objectives of the Black Panther Party were the heart of its program.
We still didn't have a name for this organization. I had gotten a pamphlet from the Lowndes County Freedom Organization. So I said, Huey, why do you got this logo for this panther here? At another point that day, Huey said, you know, I think the nature of a panther is that if you push it in the corner, and if it can't go left and it can't go right, it's going to tend to come out of that corner to wipe out the aggressor who pushed it in the corner in the first place. I said, that's what the races have done, Huey. They didn't push us black folks into the corner. We decided to name it the Black Panther Party. At first, and then we said, well, wait a minute, we're going to take a position on self-defense. So me and Huey agreed in the Black Panther Party for self-defense. So that was the night, October 22nd, the finalizing founding evening night, because this is what happened. Huey was saying, okay, we're going to have some officers. So I flipped for chairman, a coin, a silver dollar. I flip, I say, heads, I'm chairman. Boom, it land on heads. I say, I'm chairman. I go ready to hand Huey the silver dollar, and I pull back. I says, you don't need to flip. So Huey would say, what do you mean I don't need to flip? I says, wait a minute, Huey. I says, only two of us. Oh, that's right. I says, you automatically minister to defense. So I got chairman.
Yeah. Huey and Bobby said, we want to immediately end the police brutality and the murder of black people. That was rampant in the Bay Area, all over the country.
It's always been a society of working class whites pitted against blacks. They had nothing else they could do but be police and try to come out of their Oklahoma Dust Bowl, I'm gonna kick your ass nigger kind of attitude.
There was an incident where a police had shot a black man in the back and then went and plant a gun next to him and said that the guy had drawn a gun on him, which we found out after investigation, the guy didn't have no gun. Police had shot him in cold blood. Then they had another example where another black man was shot. But every young black man that was being shot during that time, the police never got indicted for murder or nothing. If anything, they got a promotion.
Oakland has one of the highest infant mortality rates among black people across the United States. Add to that miseducation, unemployment, police terror, and the rest. This all helped give rise to the Panther Party in that particular place at that time.
The real first patrol was down on 7th Street in West Oakland, California, where 11 or 12 brothers that night.
Huey, Bobby, little Bobby Hutton, the Forte brothers, Sherman, who was also a part of that first cadre, and Albert Big Man Howard.
I'm telling Huey on the walkie-talkie, because I'm riding the lead car, Huey, we got a policeman down here. There's a lot of people down here in the corner. Let's get out here, man, because he's arresting somebody. We pull over, we park legally, We're 100 and some feet away. We all pile out the cars. We're a well-organized group, and we're observing the police under the law, and we're not going to take any crap from them if they do try something. But we want to recruit the people. We're trying to capture the imagination of the people in the community to let them know. I think somebody I remember saying, what they got, sticks? Because, you know, it's dark, and people don't expect to see people with guns, black folks, right? And it's nighttime, like. And somebody said, man, no, them some goddamn guns. And somebody said, I'm getting the hell out of here. Huey tells this brother who says, I'm getting out of here. He says, no, 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 you don't have to leave. We're a new organization. We're the Black Panther Party. We're here to observe these police out here. We've been brutalizing our people in the community. So please stay. We've researched the law. Everybody know we have a right to observe the police. Well, that got the police's attention. He stands up. You have no right to observe me, he hollers at Huey. But Huey says, no. Huey's citing the specifics of the damn law. And some sister in the audience said, well, go ahead on and tell it. And another brother said, what kind of Negroes is these? And the cop says, well, is that gun loaded? He would say, if I know it's loaded, that's good enough. This scene, man, is a scene where bang, when Huey says, clap, if I know it's loaded, that's good enough, it caused little Bobby to say, yeah, that's right, I haven't jacked around the chamber. Clap. And the other brother with the long guns, clap, 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 clap. And the cop turned around and saw all these people jacking the rounds off in the chamber. It blew his mind. He was awed. He stepped over to his arrestee. He opened the back door. Unconsciously, he protected the arrestee's head, put him in the car, shut the door. Then he stopped to look at the sister. And he was shocked because the sister had the earrings on. That, well, female was even there with a big old 44 strapped down, something like Clint Eastwood or something. Well, what are we doing? We passing out the 10-point platform and program. Political education session meeting is at 2 p.m. at 5624 Grove Street up in North Oakland. Please be there, brothers and sisters, because we're going to organize some political electoral community power in the black community. That's how the Black Panther Party got started.
The party was able, came on the scene at a time in which black people had become increasingly frustrated at conditions in this country.
The whole black revolt was, as far as I was concerned, a little late coming. They should have gone forth with their activities much earlier than they did.
I came into the Black Panther Party and knowing about the Black Panther Party as a student at San Francisco City College. You had people such as Mimar Baraka, which is known as Leroy Jones at that time. You had Kwame Ture, which was Stokely Carmichael at that time. And you had Rap Brown, and you had Sonia Sanchez, all those different people. It was through going through the Black House, I came in contact with some brothers named Huey and Bobby who used to come through there from time to time.
May 2nd, 1967, when I led a delegation to the California State Legislature, 24 males and 6 females. Ronald Reagan was on the line. All the little kids he was speaking to out there on the front lawn left. These are little white kids, you know, 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. They came over. They thought we was a gun club. Need 30-odd-6, some of the little kids were saying. But the press followed them, too. Therefore, I read Executive Mandate Number 1, written by myself, Huey Newton, and Eldridge Cleaver.
The Black Panther Party for Self-Defense calls upon the American people in general and the black people in particular to take careful note of the racist California legislature, which is now considering legislation aimed at keeping the black people disarmed and powerless at the very same time racist police agencies throughout the country are intensifying the terror, brutality, murder, and repression of black people.
That gave us international notoriety because we were arrested and we was all bailed out the next day or so, et cetera, and boom.
Get your hands up.
At a traffic stop, an altercation occurred. A police officer was killed, Huey Newton was wounded, and went to jail.
I will be freed, providing that we're successful in the battle that we're engaged in now, and that is to revolutionize the court system. It all depends upon this problem.
Huey was facing the gas chamber. Bobby Seale and a handful of all the other members who'd gone to Sacramento were in jail. They were serving time. So it really wasn't much of a organization.
At that point, the Black Panther Party had totally fell apart. It didn't exist.
I was in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So I came out then in November of 1967 to work with Eldridge, organizing the support around Huey's case.
Do you have any money?
No, I'm in a severe state of poverty.
What about the Huey Newton Defense Fund?
I don't know too much about the Huey Newton Defense Fund, actually.
Who's paying your attorney's fee?
I believe the Huey Newton Defense Fund.
I come out of jail. Eldridge Cleaver is back because Huey has been shot. He has put out one issue that says, Free Huey.
Free Huey! Free Huey!
Peoples of the world are demanding that Huey P. Newton be set free, so in defense of our lives, for the survival of black people and human beings of the world, we all say in solidarity that Huey P. Newton must be set free or the sky is the limit around the world.
I reorganize and restructure the party. I extend the rules of the party in a matter of 2 months to 28 rules. You know, I create the captain and David Hilliard's position and stuff. I create all of this stuff.
Black Panther Party has revived, it's changed its name from the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense to the Black Panther Party. It's become very widely acknowledged organization in the Bay Area.
I was deputy chairman of Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Put me in touch with a lot of people in the Panther Party. The alliance was formed in 1968. The Panther Party emerged in Oakland, California, and did not have a national base. SNCC had a much longer history, had in many ways more seasoned activists. H.Rap Brown was drafted into the Black Panther Party as Minister of Justice. Kwame Ture was, or Stokely, was drafted as Prime Minister of the Afro-American Nation. James Forman was drafted as Minister of Foreign Affairs and Director of Political Education.
I can remember seeing on television people like Stokely Carmichael and others.
Violence is a part of America's culture. It is as American as cherry pie.
Against all forms of racism.
And they were scary to me even. So if it would shock a person like me being in the CIA, certainly the ordinary society and the elites, above all, who run the United States, would have been very threatened.
Black power means dignity!
See, it's no in-between. You're either free or you're a slave. There's no such thing as second-class citizenship. The only politics in this country that's relevant to black people today is the politics of revolution.
That we must arm ourselves, that we are in imminent danger, that the concentration camps in Tule Lake, in Arizona, and Oklahoma are now being rejuvenated, reset up for us, and we will defend ourselves.
I don't believe in guerrilla warfare. I think it would be both impractical, ineffective, and immoral. So I can't believe in this at all. I think we must see, on the other hand, however, that the young militants are in the revolutionary spirit, and they are concerned about revolutionizing certain values that have been existing in our society that need to be revolutionized. And I think the other thing that we must see is that, as President Kennedy said, those who make peaceful revolution impossible only make violent revolution inevitable.
Because when we start saying the war is wrong in Vietnam, while people looked at us like we were something out of space, but when they talked about the other day of the Gallup poll being 58% of the people against the war in Vietnam, then we see if you're right, you have to stand on that principle, and if it's necessary to die on the principle, because I am sick of the racist war in Vietnam when we don't have justice in the United States.
They're a bloody good bunch of killers.
We're going to commit troops to the Vietnamese people, the National Liberation Front, to fight the cowardly American aggressor.
Who's and
the Black Panther
the
Party.
Panthers.
That's right.
The question is whether our nation has the will And I submit that if we can spend $35 billion a year to fight an ill-considered war in Vietnam and $20 billion to put a man on the moon, our nation can spend billions of dollars to put God's children on their own 2 feet right here on earth.
I'm going to make this known at the Paris peace talks so that it can be accepted or rejected by the Vietnamese people. But in the spirit of internationalism and the spirit of international solidarity, we plan to do this, and we will do this for any people who are fighting against American imperialism.
You want to get to...
I've heard several comments from people that was talking about with the people, for the people, and by the people. Being a black woman from Mississippi, I've learned that long ago that's not true. It's with a handful, by a handful, by a handful. But we're going to change that, baby. We're going to change that because we're going to make democracy a reality for all of the people of this country.
And I say that that is a great need now for a radical reordering of priorities in America, and that is a great need for a revolution of values. Difficult days ahead, but it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
And then a man with a rifle blew his head open. And from the apartments and the ghettos and slums of America, and all the places he'd been, you put it on a map, and the places that Dr. King had been is where they came out in rage and bitterness that this could happen to this non-violent prophet of social change, committed, driven to create social change, to achieve social justice for all the people in the society and in the world.
Your hands up.
Some were happy. If they went, you know, if they thought black men should be killed.
I was just driving into Marlon Brando's house up in Beverly Hills. He was lying on the bed when I went in, and I said, have you heard the news? He says, what's that? I said, Martin Luther King was just shot, dead. Marlon didn't say much. He's as though he was in one of his movie roles. He got up very silently and said, so King is dead. And he went into the telephone and called up the Panther office in San Francisco. Meanwhile, I told his secretary to call the gun shop and order up a number of pistols, rifles, and so forth and so on. I said, Marlon, what are you going to do with those? He said, I'm going to shoot my way all the way to Washington, D.C.
Martin Luther King, I think he was killed, just had a plain hatred, a racial hatred.
Hoover hated Martin Luther King. I mean, it's just that simple. And he wanted Martin Luther King destroyed because he felt that he might be a messiah for the black people.
The CIA, the DIA, and others, we still don't know all of the dynamics, because we're just finding out now about the military intelligence.
I mean, our brother, Martin Luther King, exhausted a means of nonviolence with his life being taken by some racist. What is being done to us is what we hate, and what happened to Martin Luther King is what we hate. You darn right, we respect nonviolence. But nonviolence on the part of who? On the part of racists in this country, on the part of the racists who've infested the police department, who are organized and maintained by the power structure. We want nonviolence, just like Martin Luther King. But to sit and watch ourselves to be slaughtered, like our brother, like Huey was shot, etc., we must defend ourselves, as Malcolm X said, by any means necessary.
2 days later, they murdered Bobby Hutton in the shootout that had happened 2 days after Martin Luther King.
About 50 police were shooting into this one house for 90 minutes, and they didn't know who was inside. They threw in tear gas canisters to force the people to come out. The tear gas canister, one of them, exploded and caught on fire. So this was a burning basement. Eldridge and Bobby Hutton were the only people in that basement, actually. Eldridge told Bobby Hutton to take off all his clothes, because when he went out, if he was naked, the police would be shocked and they wouldn't shoot him. But he was embarrassed, and he only took off his shirt. So when he came out with just pants, he was immediately shot by 7 or 8 policemen and killed.
Bobby Hutton was 17 years old. He was a Black Panther. He'd been a Black Panther. He was one of the original founders of the Black Panther Party.
This was not a police action. It was a search and destroy mission. It was very clear that it was about killing, that the police intended to kill Panthers.
That could have been my son lying there. And I'm going to do as much as I can. I'm going to start right now.
What happened for the party after that was a tremendous upsurge in community support. People gave lots of money, gave lots of time. They could see all the things the Panthers were saying were actually true.
The fact is that some of our fellow citizens have turned against our society and turned against our government. People perhaps that you do not see, people that perhaps you do not come in contact with. Only 40% of the men that live in the ghetto have jobs that pay more than $60 a week. How can you support a family? How can you bring up children in dignity?
Robert Kennedy is the only man on the current political structure that can do the job that we need done.
Is there a second choice?
There is no second choice as far as we're concerned.
Now let's on to Chicago and let's win there.
Kennedy has been shot. Is that possible? Is that possible? It could be. Is it possible, ladies and gentlemen? It is possible. He has. Not only Senator Kennedy, oh my God. Senator Kennedy has been shot. And another man a Kennedy campaign manager, and possibly shot in the head. I am right here. Rayford Johnson has a hold of a man who apparently has fired the shot. He has fired the shot.
He still has the gun. The gun is pointed at me right at this moment.
I hope they can get the gun out of his hand.
Be very careful. Get the gun. Get the gun. Get the gun. Stay away from the gun. Stay away from the gun. His hand is frozen. Take a hold of his thumb and break it if you have to. Get his thumb. All right. That's it, Rafer. Get it. Get the gun, Rafer. Hold him. Hold him. Hold him. We don't want another Oswald.
Feel that the police must be brought under control by any means necessary, including through force of arms. And we have never bit our tongue about that. We say it now loud and clear. We will always say it. We're not afraid to say it, that these racist Gestapo pigs have to stop brutalizing our community, or we're going to take up guns. We're going to drive them out.
It is time that everybody understand that the Black Panther Party has not been trying to shuck and jive anybody. We've been trying to move this struggle from a lower to a higher level. All the people who sacrificed their lives in all organizations, not only the Black Panther Party, who are political prisoners, etc., must be defended. We understand that fascism exists in America, and we are going to create, and we're going to put together, and the years coming, and the work that faces us in the years coming, the very near future, an American Liberation Front to combat the avaricious businessman, the demagogic politician, and the fascist pig cops who murder, brutalize, and terrorize the people.
The Panthers were able to spread across the United States and exist in a number of cities.
This massive, fast, rapid growth of the Black Panther Party happened all in that period, and it was almost like a reaction to Brother Martin Luther King being murdered in that particular period. The murder of Bobby Kennedy helped solidify most of the coalition politics that went down.
And I think it was really initiated by the Panthers, who believed that we needed to unite people of all colors.
Because our objective was to coalesce with the Brown Berets, coalesce with the American Movement, et cetera, et cetera.
And that was the way we were going to change things, is by people of all colors coming together.
So we have a commonality there, a basis for unity that leads to a common struggle, if not a common result.
You know, after, because people wanted to do something, they wanted to retire to being spit on, being discriminated against. They wanted to rise up. And that's what was happening with the Red Power Movement.
The Rainbow Coalition was started by Fred Hampton in Chicago.
We said that we would work with anybody and form coalition with anybody that has revolution on their mind.
They're the ones that really came out and started showing us how to organize successfully.
Racism is an excuse used for capitalism, and we know that racism is just it's a byproduct of capitalism.
Fred Hampton had met in prison a young Puerto Rican gang leader named Chacha Jimenez and told him about the Black Panther Party and its programs and how it's serving the people and its revolutionary goals. And he had come out and turned his group, the Young Lords, into an organization very similar to the Panthers.
A number of us worked closely with them. I personally worked closely with the Black Panthers Party chapters out of Seattle, Washington, Portland, Oregon.
There was a group in Chicago called the Young Patriots of Appalachian young whites who were very radical. There's a Chinese group. The name was called the Iwar Kun. It was like, we call it the Red Guard. And we had a group called the Brown Berets.
These were the models or the institutions that we were creating, which would themselves, by example, educate and show the people that this is an alternative.
These were some very intelligent, legitimate, and kind and generous people.
And for those of us who took that step inside and who opened our doors as well, it was a relationship that would last a very long time.
I had an incident happen where I was jumped on by a gang on the south side of Chicago. And when I went to the police for help, the first policeman who was near the site in a police car, when I stumbled after being beaten for a while and my friend was still in this building being beaten, and I told him what had happened, he looked at me and said, "So what?" And I was shocked because this is not the way it was supposed to happen. That's not the way it would happen on Leave It to Beaver and Ozzie and Harriet. All of a sudden, I began to see what was going on all around me. And I started getting involved.
I tell people now, when I talk about it, I tell people it wasn't the Panthers that made me a Panther, that made me decide to join the Black Panther Party. It was the New York City Police Department.
When I did join the Black Panther Party, you thought that you just had to have a gun and that was it. And I was totally wrong. What you had to do was pick up some books and start to educate yourself.
Huey P. Newton had the capacity to mediate and meditate on all these confluent and sometimes competing elements in the history of modern thought.
The Black Panther Party was different in the sense that it considered itself a revolutionary nationalist organization. The ideological heirs of Malcolm X.
We stood for the creation of a revolutionary society where people of African descent would be given the right, not given, because the process involved in this ideology was one of the people take their rights.
Mao Zedong's writings, in particular the quotations from Mao, which is known as the Little Red Book, proved very effective for that because it helped us to develop the discipline and the techniques necessary to do our community work.
I hear this a lot from young people saying they had no idea there were any women in the civil rights movement. They had no idea there were any women in the Black Panther Party. Of course there were women. There were women leaders in the civil rights movement. There were women leaders in the Black Panther Party. I was the central committee member. I was the communication secretary of the Black Panther Party.
The persons who tended to have the most sophisticated and intellectual understanding of revolutionary concepts and ideology and who had more maturity and sophistication in organizing skills tended to be women. Women like Fannie Shakur, Joan Bird, Asada Shakur, Kathleen Cleaver.
There were women at every demonstration. There were women who were arrested in some of the shootouts, such as the Los Angeles office when they paraded all the Panthers out. Among the people arrested were women. There were women on trial, such as Erica Huggins, when Bobby Seale was tried for a conspiracy to commit murder. So was Erica. It wasn't like the women's section or the women's auxiliary and the men Panthers. We're all in this together.
We were involved in the process of re-socializing and re-educating ourselves as Black men to the contradictions of sexism in the Black community.
Come on in, little brother. Come on in, little sister. Y'all can sit down and get something to eat.
Sisters and brothers.
This was a powerful thing that the Black Panther Party was about. Again, with the programs like the breakfast program, the health clinic, the prisoner visitation program.
I remember the sickle cell anemia program. Check this out. In 1968, the Black Panther Party, sickle cell anemia was not noted in the United States like it is today.
I mean, health care is essential to your life. And to be denied health care because you don't have the money to pay is like saying, well, your life isn't worth anything. And so to have this clinic available, and the clinics that exist today because of what was started then, these clinics provide a service that is invaluable.
We were constantly 24 hours a day doing something, working with our community and supporting our community and cleaning up our community.
These are not the types of activities that are done by a gang.
Jesse Andrew, who was the treasurer of the state of California, said that the Black Panther Party was feeding more hungry children than the United States government.
what, as far as the food program, we went out to the merchants in the community.
I mean, we would ask them a simple question: how much of this money that you've made within the in your business have you contributed back to the community? And over 90% of them said zero.
And we approached them for canned goods or food or day-old bread or fresh food, whatever the case might be. So they donated. And that's how we got to serving people in the community who didn't have food or went to school on an empty stomach.
And so at 5 o'clock in the morning, you'd have to get up from the Panther pad over there and go over to this breakfast program, start up the stove and make the breakfast, and then make sure it's ready in a timely fashion. And it's a hot breakfast with the sausages and the eggs and the grits.
And if it called for us to stay there and scrub the walls and do whatever was necessary, we would do that.
We feed about 10,000 across the country each day.
Well, of course, we started our own programs too. You know, the American Indian Movement, we started, but we patterned them after the Black Panthers organizations. We had free breakfasts, we built schools, we have our own clinics. We went into, of course, communications. A lot of the things that the Panthers did, we patterned our ideas off of, you know.
The Young Lords Party and the Black Panther Party wanted every municipal hospital that serviced the poor in New York to have an acupuncture experimental center inside of their drug program. And because we were the first, we became targets. 100 policemen came to the Bronx and arrested us and took us away from the center.
When these efforts started to show a little bit of success, that's when the government moved in.
COINTELPRO was the code word for counterintelligence program, and it was a program that the FBI created in 1956 to go after the Communist Party with intentions of trying to neutralize the party, put it out of business.
In 1967, they start what became known as MH Chaos, a code word for illegal domestic operations within the United States.
We can say that the COINTELPRO was a kind of codification for white supremacy in America, because the function of the FBI was to preserve white political, social, economic supremacy in America.
Counterintelligence staff under James Angleton was not the only CIA office which was involved in illegal operations within the United States and with the general attempt to get information on the foreign hand in the protest movement. The Office of Security was another major effort by the CIA.
I've seen top secret documents from the White House authored by Nixon communicating with J. Edgar Hoover specifically about the Panthers.
Hoover had, well, if you want to call it an enemy list, had lists, but it's difficult to say what Nixon's men had. They pulled the Watergate, so they, I guess they could do just about anything.
The Black Panther Party was looked at as the number one threat to the internal security of the United States of America. These are word by word, verbatim quotes from J. Edgar Hoover.
The year of 69, every branch and office of the Black Panther Party in one way, shape, fashion, form, or another was attacked by the power structure, law enforcement agencies, and so on.
There's people walking around out there like walking wounded, you know. It's just like they've been in Vietnam, victims of gun battles and sieges and isolation and torture and destroyed families and dead parents. But nobody knows about them and nobody really cares. And that story is one that hasn't been told yet.
At the University of California at Los Angeles, two Black Panthers were shot to death during a black students' meeting on the campus last Friday.
Two FBI informants and the United Slaves had shot and killed Bunchy Carter and John Huggins on the UCLA campus.
US organization slapped a member of Black Panther Party at the time, Elaine Brown.
I was going with John Huggins, so when she told him that somebody from the US organization had slapped her, he pulled his pistol out. This is when the two brothers, or supposedly Steiner brothers, supposedly steps out from behind the doors and open fire and kills John and kills Bunchy.
And the FBI agent who was controlling two informants was concerned that some white students might have been shot on campus.
The members of the US organization were taken from the crime scene with the FBI.
The government or whoever, Power, COINTEL, whatever, they were able to kill a party when they killed Bunchy. When they killed Bunchy, they killed the party. We just didn't know it.
April 1st, 1969, we were taken down to the Manhattan District Attorney's office in the wee hours of the morning after having been roused from bed by teams of machine gun-toting policemen. Gene Roberts had the dubious distinction of having been Malcolm X's bodyguard when he was assassinated. He was one of the major agents in the Panther 21 case.
They brought us all in and put us in one room. They brung Ralph White Sedan, the other undercover agent, with his sawed-off shotgun, and they brung him in with his head down like he's under arrest, took him in another room, and they had Gene Roberts sitting in another office, sitting down, looking like he was depressed, like he was arrested.
And it was down there that we realized that there were three undercover agents that were actively involved in framing us for the charges for which we were arrested.
After they get the conspiracy charges on you, they let the agents out the side door, and they go back out in the community as nothing's wrong, or they were still Panthers when they wasn't Panthers at all. They were just agents that infiltrated the Black Panther Party.
Most of the Panther 21 spent 2 years in prison after a trial that lasted 15 months. A jury came back with a not guilty verdict in 45 minutes on all 150 counts of conspiracy. It was a colossal victory to have defeated the state's attempt to criminalize the leadership of the Black Panther Party.
Eldridge Cleaver, the Black Panther leader who fled to Cuba to avoid being returned to jail, arrived in Algeria today to attend a Pan-African cultural festival in Algiers.
FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover today asserted that of the black extremist groups, the Black Panthers represent the greatest internal threat to the nation. In his report for fiscal year 1969, Hoover said the Panthers have perpetrated numerous assaults on police and have engaged in violent confrontations throughout the country.
You might murder a freedom fighter like Bobby Hutton, but you can't murder freedom fighting. And if you do, you come up with answers that don't answer, explanations that don't explain. You come up with conclusions that don't conclude.
Fred Hampton, who, by the way, I would look at as one of the true leaders of the Panthers.
Extraordinarily talented. 21 years old. Articulate. Watch some of his films, hear him speak. Here was a dangerous man. He could persuade people that there was injustice, that the United States ought to be changed.
Black people need some peace. White people need some peace. And we are going to have to fight. We're going to have to struggle. We're going to have to struggle relentlessly to bring about some peace, because the people that we're asking for peace, they're a bunch of megalomaniac warmongers, and they don't even understand what peace means.
He was the heart and soul of the Chicago chapter of the Black Panther Party. And just an awesome motivator.
We hate the oppressor, whether he be white, black, brown, or yellow.
And he began to forge coalitions between various street gangs or youth organizations in Chicago. And by doing that, and by being a charismatic leader and being one who could mobilize the people, and particularly the youth, he became noticed by the federal government.
We might not be back. I might be in jail. I might be anywhere. But when I leave, you can remember I said with the last words on my lips that I am a revolutionary, and you're gonna have to keep on saying that.
The FBI never personally killed any Panthers. They always had local police departments do their dirty work, and they began to devise a scheme that culminated in his assassination while he was asleep, drugged by his security officer, who was also a police informant.
City police in Chicago murdered Fred Hampton.
It had happened apparently about 4 o'clock in the morning on December 4th. I didn't hear about it until 6 o'clock that night because I wasn't in town. And they popped this picture up on the screen. Actually, 2 pictures, one of Fred Hampton and one of Mark Clark. And I was just stunned. I was just staring at the screen and I realized I was crying.
They shot that place up in ways you couldn't believe. His wife, pregnant, shot up in the bed there. She survived, as did the fetus, but Fred's body was riddled. The walls of the room, riddled. I mean, you could count scores of bullet holes there. He never got out of the bed. He was murdered right there. 2:30 in the morning, they claim they're serving a search warrant. But don't we know anything about human rights? You don't serve a search warrant at 2:30 in the morning. You don't come crashing in with guns blazing and kill people asleep in their beds in the United States of America, or do you?
In essence, was an assassination authorized by the FBI or sanctioned by the FBI.
Hi, and it's code 4148 North St. Andrews. Caller heard not seen.
The Criminal Conspiracy Unit of LAPD, their mission in life was to investigate extremist groups, primarily the Black Panthers. And the FBI had a special unit called the S2 unit. They euphemistically called it their racial squad. Their focus was on the Black Panther Party. So the FBI's racial squad and the LAPD's criminal conspiracy section worked literally hand in hand in bringing down the LA Black Panther Party and its leadership, Pratt in particular.
When Bunchy Carter and John Huggins had been assassinated, Pratt became the leader of the Panthers, and now the FBI had to get rid of Pratt.
Geronimo Pratt was a Vietnam veteran. He'd been a paratrooper and won many medals in Vietnam, including a Purple Heart. He trained all the Panthers in Los Angeles on how to defend the office against attack. He was the defense minister, so he was clearly somebody that the FBI was out to neutralize.
December 8, 1969, Los Angeles, Special Weapons and Tactics, Criminal Conspiracy Section, LAPD, FBI.
Black Panthers, as we all know, were destroyed as an organization through these illegal FBI operations. And certainly the CIA violated the privacy and the rights of thousands upon thousands of Americans through the illegal operations which they agreed to do under Richard Helms as director.
Any and everything was done to members of the Black Panther Party to destroy not only the Black Panther Party and other organizations, but to demoralize people, to discredit us in the eyes of the people, to criminalize our existence in the consciousness and minds of the people.
It's physical violence and torture per se. There's nothing modern about it.
and there is nothing sophisticated or scientific about it. It is the base against which psychological warfare has its meaning.
We went to interview Dr. Mutulu Shakur, who had cured thousands of drug addicts with the experimental treatment of acupuncture. We found him in an underground prison.
The Black Liberation Movement in 1969 lost something like 43 people were killed, and something like 785 people were arrested and put in prison. In any other country with the population that New African people represent, in any other country in the world, that would be considered war.
We went to interview Mumia Abu-Jamal, the Peabody Award-winning journalist. We found him awaiting execution on death row.
In essence, when one looks at the aims and objectives of the federal government through the FBI, by way of the COINTELPRO program, what one really sees is a war against Black America, a war against in the words of the files, in fact, the emergence of a Black Messiah who could lead Black America.
In 1970, there were tremendous trials. The United States government began to try to sweep up all of the leftovers of the 60s into these major conspiracies. And they had the Black Panther trial, the Chicago 7 trial, the LA 17 trial, the Wilmington 10 trial, the RNA 11 trial. There was just tons and tons of these types of trials. Many of our people went to the wayside psychologically, emotionally, and physically.
15-hour shootouts, Philadelphia, New Orleans, Los Angeles, San Diego. The frame-up of hundreds of Panthers across the country on ridiculous trumped-up charges.
I was arrested. I was 19 years old. We were the first Waco. The New African, New Bethel incident, when the police came in, the Detroit police came in there to try to shoot up. Everybody in that church, men, women, and children, were having a peaceful demonstration to try to kill them. They were shooting under the pews. They were shooting at little children running and crying.
There's nothing to me has been more painful out of all the people I know that died in Vietnam than those comrades who died out here in the streets. There is nothing, nothing.
In 1970, my good friend Julio Rodan of the Young Lords Party was killed in the New York prison called the Tombs.
If they were doing it in Vietnam and it was perfectly legitimate to go out and kill as many Vietnamese as one could, or Viet Cong as one could, then why not kill enemies in the United States?
Today, a judge set Newton free on $50,000 bond to await a new trial.
Newton's last trial and manslaughter conviction were overturned by a higher court this year, so now he'll be tried again. And in the meantime, he is out on bail. He is back on the street. Before Newton got out of prison, the founder of the Black Panther Party sat and talked about his plans for the Panthers now.
I plan to go on with our expansion and also to make even a stronger tie with the struggling people of the world because they represent two-thirds of the people.
J. Edgar Hoover today characterized the Black Panthers as the most dangerous and violence-prone of all the extremist groups now active in the United States.
There were forces at foot trying to undermine the relationship between not only myself and the leadership of the Black Panther Party, national leadership, but between the various forces within the Black Panther Party who wanted to make the Black Panther Party more responsive and democratic, and those who wanted to maintain the Black Panther Party as an extension of autocratic control of a Central Committee.
The Central Committee of the Black Panther Party, when I come out of jail, I reorganize it again. Huey was actually opposed to this. I says, nope, we have to have a broader Central Committee. Because when I come out of jail, Huey was sitting there with him and David, he went to jail, and Elaine Brown and a couple of other people, and said, this is our Central Committee. And I says, Huey, this whole Supreme Commander crap has got to go. And these are the private conversations I had with Huey, you know? So my point becomes, he was trying to absolutize himself.
We had felt that all the contradictions that was happening between David Hilliard and all the other people in the party, and the central leadership and the breakdown in centralism and all of that, would be resolved when Huey came home.
When Huey came out, Geronimo remained a member of the Central Committee.
For whatever reason, Huey, after he got out of jail, he wanted to have the total control of the party, but the way the party was set up with the Central Committee, that was impossible. Geronimo, being one of the strongest personalities on the Central Committee, just had to be eliminated.
It was around this time that Elmer Geronimo Pratt was captured and branded as an agent by David Hilliard and the Central Committee of the Black Panther Party on the West Coast. Of course, this was a total fabrication. Geronimo was not an agent. In fact, the individual who pointed the finger at Geronimo and declared him an agent, Melvin Cotton Smith, was himself a police informer, an agent, who was assigned to Geronimo by David Hilliard.
A split apparently has opened in the leadership of the Black Panther Party. On a San Francisco television talk show, Huey Newton, in the studio, talked with fugitive Eldridge Cleaver, speaking by telephone from Algeria. Cleaver said a purge of Black Panther members is tearing the party apart, blamed it on David Hilliard, and demanded the ouster of Hilliard as Panther chief of staff.
Many of those confrontations, both on the West Coast and between the East Coast and the West Coast, happened because of the COINTELPRO program, what they called Program Brown Mail. They would write to one person and sign their letter. They would write to another person and sign each other's person's signature.
And it really cracked the Black Panther Party in two by creating two factions.
All of this was happening at the same time that Huey Newton was planning his itinerary to come back east, and the government used the hysteria and the paranoia around these issues to give Huey the impression that the New York Panthers were unloyal to him.
They wrote to people, in my name, signed my signature. And these were crazy letters that were written by the FBI. And Jeff Fort got a letter from Chairman Fred. Of course, they thought those letters were from each other. And the tone of the letters were incendiary. Well, you're a punk. If I see you, I'm going to, you know, shoot you. You're a coward. If you had guts, you would come down here. I mean, it was literally an attempt by this government to incite violence.
COINTELPRO was the whole cause of the split between the different factions in the party that caused the death of Sam Napier.
In terms of the actual physical integrity and well-being of the Panther, Sam Napier might have been the most important person. The newspaper was the most important entity and tool and institution that the Panthers had. And he was in charge of the paper.
The loss of Sam Napier wasn't just the loss of a person who was a paper salesman. It was like the spirit in the party, a strong, positive spirit that permeated the whole party. You lost like a friend, a brother.
Robert Webb was the ranking Panther in the entire East Coast. He had the rank of field marshal, which was a Central Committee position. It was an underground secret rank.
The police knew who these people were. The police knew that they had orchestrated this conflict. And they gloated over it in their documents when they said that they could take credit for the murder, for Robert Webb's murder, and that they could take credit for the irreconcilable differences in splitting the Black Panther Party. When Huey Newton came to the Northeast, we in New York were responsible for his security. The government knew this through their agents and through the mail. They sent threats, death threats to Huey Newton, purportedly coming from us on the East Coast, saying that, you know, we were faithful to Eldridge Cleaver and that when Huey came back East, we were going to kill him. And it was up at Yale University that Huey Newton sort of like got extremely paranoid. I was told that I was suspended from the Black Panther Party for threatening his life.
So life is very tough, and a funny thing happened to all of us on the way to the grave.
Huey, David sent me underground with Geronimo, but with no intentions of us being successful, but with the intentions of us eventually being killed. I think their plan was that we would be killed by the police. We would then become martyrs. They would be able to raise us as martyrs and go on with their own program. I followed orders, did what I was supposed to. Geronimo followed orders, did what he was supposed to. And then we end up being in the middle of the split between the Black Panther Party, and they use that as a reason to expel us and to break with Eldridge.
And at the same time that this was going on, the Panther 21 in prison were contemplating writing an open letter criticizing the leadership of the Black Panther Party around various issues.
It was only two things that could happen, that we could either do spend the rest, go to prison or the cemetery. And knowing that people like Truman Myers and Robert Webb and Sam Napier, Fred Bennett, and Fred Hampton had made the ultimate sacrifices, that meant that we could either back up and give up and let them win, or we could struggle against it. On one end, we had the Huey people who were out to do us in, and on the other side, we had the government who was out to kill us. So we were in between the rock and the hard place.
Out of that came the birth of the Underground, the Black Liberation Army, the armed wing of the Black Panther Party, whose stated purpose was to start and initiate an offensive military campaign against the forces of reaction.
BLA came into being when those who did political work above ground, when they were more or less from the repressive forces, was forced underground because of their political work in the community. Then they became part of BLA.
So basically it was taking the war to the enemy instead of waiting the enemy to bring the war to you. And that's what the Black Liberation Army was about.
The public at large has a hard time understanding how often innocent people are wrongly convicted.
Los Angeles Police Department, the DA's office, and the FBI were determined that Pratt should stay behind bars. And so they tried to find some other case to bring against him. And they finally decided on an unsolved murder case called the Tennis Court Murder that came out of Santa Monica and charged him with this on the basis of some shenanigans involving a FBI informant named Julius Butler.
Julius Butler said at Pratt's trial he was not an FBI informant. We have a ton of material that clearly indicate that Butler was an FBI informant. As an example, here we have an FBI Federal Bureau of Investigation, August 19, 1969, and all the information he was giving the FBI during that interview.
Of course, the FBI is going to place itself in a position of being able to deny whatever happens, just the way they're denying that Julius Butler was an informant.
Butler said that he has written a letter containing information relating to an involvement of BP members in an affair that could put them in a gas chamber.
I mean, they had an informant file, and Butler was contacted about 36 times, but they said, well, he's not an informant.
Butler said that he was expelled from the BPP in August of 1969. At Pratt's trial, he said he was not expelled, that he quit.
Now, according to FBI's own records, their own telephone tap, they later realized that Geronimo Pratt was in Oakland at the time of the tennis court murder.
The ballistics person came in and testified that the bullet taken from the victim did not match ballistically the barrel of the gun. Well, the way they got around that was they had Julius Butler, as part of his confession, tell the jury that not only did Pratt confess the crime to me, that he did it, but he also told me that he threw the barrel of the gun away. So that took care of that.
The counterintelligence program had successfully divided the Black Panther Party into two opposing groups, and the Newton group had barred any members of its group from having anything to do, speaking on the phone, talking to, and definitely not testifying in trial of the other group. Geronimo Pratt had been expelled. He was in the other group. And so almost all the people who had attended these staff meetings in which he was present, in which I was present, were unable, upon pain of being expelled from the Panther Party, to testify.
This murder in Geronimo's case clearly was not Geronimo. Then those government agents need to be brought to justice. And that's the responsibility of people in this country at this point in time.
The FBI's considered an attempt to try to smash the Black Panther Party. They stopped actually attacking us. Didn't mean they didn't have no covert crap going on.
Infiltration of cocaine into the Black Panther Party, its leadership, Huey P. Newton being the main target.
And every once in a while, I say, Huey, why are you snorting this cocaine? This ain't the thing. Now, I don't say this because I'm trying to destroy Huey's character. What I'm trying to tell people is you have to learn to know the whole truth.
I had a clear impression that chemical warfare would be utilized against the Black Panther Party. We had taken a position in our rules against anyone shooting heroin and narcotics found would be immediately dismissed from the Black Panther Party because we essentially were anti-drug in our operations. I'd say, in my analysis and reflection and research, that there were mind control operations run against the Black Panther Party, as well as a lot of other operations, psychological warfare programs. And when I say chemical warfare, I'm talking about chemical substances like alcohol and cocaine.
MK Ultra was what you might call a research program by the CIA to determine if psychotropic drugs, mind-altering drugs, might be used for intelligence purposes, either for chemical warfare, for the interrogation of intelligence assets, or the neutralization of targets.
See, you have to remember, if you read some of the COINTELPRO documents, they had a psychological profile on Huey, on me, on Eldridge. They knew they could use Huey, and they knew that they could trick Eldridge into a certain level of thinking. So, they had developed this over a period of time. Now, here we got a situation where you got some party members that talk to me that they believe Huey got duped in to, on a small scale level, methodologically destroying the party.
And the party basically went from a people's organization to Huey's private army. That's basically what happened.
It was agreed that I would run for mayor of Oakland, and then Huey insisted that Elaine Brown had to run for city councilwoman at large. We lose the goddamn campaign. And then I found out, late May 1974, that Huey was trying to take over the drug trade in Oakland, California. So I said, Huey, the party is over.
The committee will resolve itself into executive session. The room will be cleared and swept.
No director of the National Security Agency has ever before been required by Congress to testify in open session.
There is a great deal about the best intelligence service in the world that we would be proud to tell, to bring into perspective what we have had to say recently about the missteps or misdeeds of the past.
I believe that I could go back over my experiences in the Justice Department and find some areas in which the Bureau is not fully accountable to me. Yes, Senator.
William C. Sullivan, who retired as the FBI's chief investigator 6 years ago after falling out with J. Edgar Hoover, was killed in a deer hunting accident in New Hampshire today. Sullivan was 65.
Bill Sullivan, who was the number three man in the Bureau in charge of Division 5 Domestic Intelligence, expressed extreme remorse to me about his role in suggesting an anonymous letter to Martin Luther King for Dr. King to commit suicide a week before he was going to be called upon to testify before the House Committee on Assassinations. He was out in a pasture near his New Hampshire home, and he was mistaken, supposedly, for a deer by a young man out hunting, and was killed.
I understand from the news media that the son was an experienced hunter, and I don't know how an experienced hunter could mistake a man who's dressed in a red plaid jacket for the head of a deer. I mean, I have never seen a red deer, but you know, maybe they're out there somewhere.
But if I could get a virtuous woman, then I'm a
Who's the boss?
Well, in a human society, there aren't really any bosses, but who is the real leader and who is the person whose words are most meaningful to the party as a whole? There isn't any question about it. I mean, it always, that Huey is that person.
I had the distinct impression consistently from 1971 that Ms. Elaine Brown was a highly placed intelligence operative inside the Black Panther Party.
I think Elaine Brown came in through Earl Anthony, and she followed the same course of devious type of activities. So I'm saying all this to say that they got involved with people and caused a lot of problems, but we was aware of it. We just wasn't aware of the extent that the LAPD, the federal government with its COINTEL, the CIA, FBI, we wasn't aware of to the extent that these people were involved.
She acknowledges in her own words, in her book, Taste of Power, that in fact she had been educated, groomed, taught at the hands of a longtime Central Intelligence Agency operative, J. Richard Kennedy, who anyone can find out about in David Garrow's book, The FBI and Dr. Martin Luther King.
So many party members literally have told me they believe this, that this woman was connected some kind of way and got step by step, piece by piece, got Huey hooked over into some notion that he could get more money behind the scene if he step by step, methodologically, demised the Black Panther Party.
We've always wanted to represent the will of the people. They're not interested in socialism at this time because they believe that they can get their just desserts in this capitalist system. When the people democratically want a change in system to a socialist system, then the party will be the first to have solidarity.
John Stockwell, former station chief of the CIA in Angola, he said, well, I want to say this to you very clear. The Huey P. Newton that people see today is a direct result of operations run by the Central Intelligence Agency to ensure that he would turn out the way that he is.
Some people have a distorted view of me, and it gives me very much trouble. It adds to the sort of timid personality that I already have. It makes me uncomfortable. Because I know that I can't give them all of those things that their idol is supposed to. And I don't want to appear to them a fake, but I would just like to tell them that, you know, I'm just another regular human being.
Huey P. Newton was never the same. He eventually became Dr. Huey P. Newton, PhD. He eventually became a crackhead, and he eventually was assassinated in Oakland in 1989. In the course of our journey, we discovered that certain individuals involved in the demise of the Black Panther Party were also the same individuals who were involved in the demise of the American Indian Movement.
It began in 1973 after the Church Committee hearings, when they proclaimed that they were never going to execute covert operations against dissenting organizations. Yet, at the very time they were conducting such an operation against the American Indian Movement, a program directed towards the American Indian Movement very similar to the program directed against the Black Panther Party.
The same bag of tricks in each case. You have a very concerted disinformation campaign. You have the insertion of infiltrators and the development of informants. The use of the infiltrators as provocateurs, attempting to convert bona fide activists into provocateurs or disruptive elements within their own organization. They literally would unleash death squads to make sure that the people who were living on the $1,200 a year in the tar paper shack would continue to live on the $1,200 and in a tar paper shack.
One of the personnel who were involved in persecuting and later framing Geronimo Pratt was also involved in the fabrication of evidence to convict Leonard Peltier. This was an FBI agent by the name of Richard W. Held.
Well, Richard the Elder, which is Richard G. Held, was basically one of the architects of COINTELPRO.
Strangely enough, both the father and son were involved in the operation on Pine Ridge, which led to the frame-up of Leonard Peltier on murder charges.
Basically, the paramilitary operations of 250 to 300 FBI agents, SWAT personnel, on the reservation for about a three-month period of time to once and for all break the back of the American Indian Movement.
Armored personnel carriers with heavy machine guns, M-16s wearing camouflage uniforms, overflights by Phantom F-4 reconnaissance jets and Huey helicopters, and remote sensing devices. It was very much like what was deployed in Vietnam at that time.
When the people went into Wounded Knee, there were chiefs and elders and some of the American Indian Movement members. These were the Ogallala people. They didn't have any weapons. They went in there peacefully. They were surrounded with machine guns, armored personnel carriers, so the people picked up arms. And, you know, there were no comparison what the government had. We shot back. It was self-defense.
The government spent nearly $1 billion in the military operation on Pine Ridge. And that's $1 billion 1975 or $1973. That's probably more than all the money invested in social programs on that reservation from 1870 onward. A people's movement to control the resources and land on the reservations happened to coincide with the energy crisis. In the Black Hills, there were at least a dozen large multinational corporations, energy corporations, involved. And the government purports to represent the people, but it really represents vested economic interests. The movements that are working for positive social change threaten the interests of the transnational corporations, and the government is essentially an instrument of corporate policy.
Leonard Peltier, leader of AIM, the American Indian Movement, had been in jail for 20 years. We finally got permission to interview him. 3 days after we saw him at Leavenworth, he was moved. No one knew where to.
Leonard Peltier is a prisoner of the longest war in the history of the United States. That's the war against the indigenous people of the United States.
And he didn't shoot anybody and he didn't kill anybody, yet he was convicted because two FBI agents had been killed, and somebody had to pay.
The question then becomes, what is he in that cage for? And the answer is to serve as an example of the arbitrary ability of the government of the United States to repress the legitimate aspirations for liberation of Native people, all Native people. He serves that purpose. So long as he's there, even though it's known that he's not guilty of the specific offense which he was convicted.
He's been sentenced to 2 life sentences. But finally, they admitted in the last argument of the case in November of 1992, and that they didn't know who shot the 2 FBI agents. They said it several times in different ways without any ambiguity. We don't know who killed the agents. We don't know who fired the fatal shots. And yet here's Leonard Peltier serving these sentences. We're addressing President Clinton to give clemency to Leonard Peltier in the name of simple justice. Now.
The United States Army, of course, has its contingency plans for putting down civil disturbance in the United States. They had these programs in the 1960s called Cable Splicer and Garden Plot for entering onto the scene in the event of civil disturbance in the United States. These activities continued on into the 1980s, but the main agency that became involved in the on the civilian side was FEMA. The Federal Emergency Management Agency.
The FEMA has created a great deal of paranoia, probably for very good reason. Their whole reason for existence is to take control and keep things going in time of a crisis of, you know, earthquake or military crisis. In the instance of a military or political crisis, we don't know what extremes they're willing to go to. They've drawn up their martial law plans.
One of the things that that grew out of the military contingency planning, such as Cable Splicer and Garden Plot, was the military assistance to the police forces in organizing these and training these SWAT squads. These are, in fact, outright militarized police units, even though they are civilian. And the United States military, the Army particularly, had much to do with the establishment of these units through the 1960s and into the 70s. Now, I think all the way across the country there are SWAT units everywhere. And they started out in places like Chicago, I believe, and Los Angeles. But they were done with the help of the U.S. military.
Well, Rex 84 was a plan to draw up to collect dissidents around the country who might be involved in violent activity and throw them basically in detainment camps. Some people call them concentration camps.
They had, I believe, something like 17 military installations selected in the United States, where they would house up to, I believe, something like 150,000 or 250,000 people in the event that the streets turned to chaos if Reagan had invaded Central America in the early 1980s.
So. Despite what the director of FBI, the FBI may be saying currently, you can assume that they're still conducting covert operations.
They were going to round up every dissident and every person who took to the street, plus a lot of foreigners, at the same time, because they did not want to have the situation develop as it had against Johnson and Nixon over the Vietnam War. So in the early 80s, Reagan said all he had to, it was all prepared, the statement, declaring martial law, suspending the Constitution, and then they could go out and take everybody over to these military reservations, the equivalent of concentration camps, and just hold them there until what he wanted to do was done.
The government is definitely shifting intelligence resources to the private sector. And one of the reasons for this is to escape public scrutiny under a law such as the Freedom of Information Act. Freedom of Information Act only applies to government agencies.
You have to imagine technology 20, 30 years in advance of what we're using today. All that is classified, and it's classified for a very good reason, because it's being put to criminal uses.
Bugging and interception of private communication, the disappearance of privacy, you might say. What's going on now is that there are large private corporate databases accumulated that accumulate information on individuals, track their activities, track their economic activities. These corporations, we call themselves credit corporations or whatever, but they're essentially intelligence operations.
Please listen, my brother and my sister too. Although these lines may not apply to you, we need less ill and less killing, more chilling. We can reach the pinnacle if our mind is willing. Less drinking, more thinking. What the hell is shocking? Our minds, body, spirits, what the hell is shocking? I mean to suggest, what the hell is shocking? We can live a little better. I do profess. To see the stony leads to the bottle, bottle to the joint. It's a domino effect. If you get my point, the joint to the coat to the dope, and you know what? The way can be the dead or broke.
If the ultimate weapon is a bigger subsidy, we will use it. It is worth it. It's worth $50 million this year, if that's what it costs to buy a $3 million crop, if it'll do the job. Now, it may be there'll be social problems and the political problems and the rest, and their embarrassment that won't do the job. My guess is that $50 million wouldn't do it, but it is worth it to this country. If that will do the job, pay $50 million.
How it is that the United States, with all its military services, the Coast Guard, the CIA, the FBI, the DEA, and cooperating agencies, including local police departments, how they are not able to suppress the drug trade in the United States, how they cannot seal the borders and stop these shipments coming in, and then the whole distribution system.
The nature of the drug use and of availability of drugs began to change as the Vietnam War went bad. Specifically, there was a shift from the availability of relatively innocuous drugs like marijuana and hashish on the street to those drugs becoming relatively scarce due to federal drug programs, and they're appearing instead a large quantity of a very pure, very cheap heroin.
DEA, FBI, CIA, military, they're all into this international narcotics trafficking. So it doesn't mean that any particular target is only the area of one intelligence agency, because there are all kinds of interagency working groups in which they coordinate their activities directed toward a single target.
The drug trade always supports the government's internal political agenda. It has never not supported the government's internal political agenda. For an example, the phenomena that we saw with the Nicaraguan situation, with the which we call the Iran-Contra affair, Iran had less to do with the Iran-Contra affair, in our opinion, than Colombia, because it was the Colombian drug pushers which opened up avenues for finance that the United States government could not get legally from the Congress.
Some of the Hmong tribes people were involved in the production of poppies, and under the CIA, that production greatly increased, and the revenues from the sale of those drugs, which were flown out by CIA proprietary airlines, were used to further finance covert operations by the CIA.
So what the United States government did was to get the ready cash through Elliott Abrams that allowed drugs, cocaine, to come into these poor communities all over the country as a means to then serve the secondary agenda, which is to sedate and control and criminalize as many of those black and Latin people that they can.
One of the effects is to take totally out of the political picture a whole generation or two of young black males who either get involved in the drug trade and end up in prison, or who get involved in consumption and do not get involved in politics.
It's the state that builds the archipelago of prisons. It's the state that invents a rhetoric of three strikes and you're out. It's the state that invents a vocabulary that is soaked in crime, which is meant to describe the lives of young people, adolescents, basically.
I've spent 19 years in prison in the United States for my political beliefs. You were the symbol that helped sustain me and other African-American political prisoners. I say to you, brother, we love you, and we will not give up the fight. We will not give up the fight. We will not give up the fight. We will not give up the fight.
I think we've had political prisoners in the United States for a very long time. On an official level, they would not admit this.
Of course there are political prisoners in the United States, even if the U.S. government will never admit to them. Political prisoners are the heartbeat of the struggle, reminders of what the struggle is really about. They have been behind the wall now 15, 20, and going on 25 years. They must not be forgotten.
So while I'm sitting here in prison today with 115 witnesses, 532 exhibits, electronic surveillance, electronic eavesdropping, no fingerprints, no blood, no weapon, no words, nothing ever said against me. But I'm convicted.
To this date, at least 800 pages of COINTELPRO and ADEX, or Agitator Index files, have been released to my lawyers in my name. Of course, thousands have not been. They're still classified.
We believe that the Congressional Black Caucus should have a hearing to determine the effect of COINTELPRO on the new African independence movement, the Black Liberation Movement, like they did to the left. That the parties responsible must admit their wrong in those attacks of violation of those people's constitutional rights. It will then set a tone of reconciliation.
A single stone or a grain of sand, as we are each individuals, if we change ourselves, if we do one small thing, it's much better than people trying to do big things and for their self-aggrandizement.
Government and the system, the industrial forces that are a plague on Mother Earth, that are destroying the water, the air, the earth itself, the genetic material within us all, it isn't just destroying it for people in Africa or people in Southeast Asia or people in Latin America. It's destroying it for every being on Earth. And I mean every being. I don't mean every man, woman, and child. I mean every living entity.
All through history, no matter how much power has surged through totalitarian, through empires, rulers, and conquerors, whether they be governments or individuals as dictators or despots or tyrants, history has always shown that the human spirit will always prevail.
We do not exist as individuals. All of us have a mother and a father. So we come from a collectivity of these two beings. We cannot ignore that and say, well, I am. There is no I am. There is only we are. We are collective. All of us breathe the same air. We share the same sunlight. The feelings that I have in my heart are feelings that you have in your heart. We share spiritual vibrations.
Love is natural. Hate is unnatural. Hate breeds hate. So, but you know, but I have never known where you have overcome hate with hate, but you can overcome hate with love and respect.
I'll just say it in the words of Bob Marley, stand up for your rights. Don't let anybody tell you what you can and you cannot do. You can organize, you can educate, you can make a difference.
We have to learn how to sit down and talk with each other first. Until we can sit down and speak with each other, sit down as men and women, sit across from each other and break bread, and to learn that we're human beings. I don't care, you know, how low you are considered in poverty, or what nationality, or how rich you are. Until we can learn to sit down with each other and discuss the problems, we're not going to be able to accomplish that.
Revolution is, first of all, change, personal transformation. Revolution is not a word to be afraid of, because revolution is ultimately the most natural thing in the universe. Revolution is speaking truth to power. It is people recognizing their historical identity and their future duty and necessity to transform this reality into a better reality.
I just want to be sure that everyone knows that I still have the fire in the belly, that I'll do what I can to be as productive from here as I can, that I have legal cases that will put these issues in the public record, and we will continue to share that with whoever, and that the international community should know that the new African independence struggle and the struggle for justice is live and well. It's dormant, but here comes the wind. Free Mamiya.
At the end of this journey, let us look inside our hearts with forgiveness, remembering not only the past and all those whose lives were sacrificed to violence, but let us also examine how we are going to survive together as humanity into the future, with peace and justice for all.